the world that we see around us is built on a story. Every culture has a different set of answers to these basic questions of who are you? What is it to be a human being? What's important? What's valuable? Where do we come from? Where are we going? How does the world work? Every culture answers this in a different way. And science provides some answers. It says basically that what you are is a discrete, separate individual among other individuals in a universe that's separate from you as well. And every field has agreed with this characterization of what it is to exist. Psychology, you're this bubble of psychology, or this mind encased in flesh. Religion, you are a soul encased in flesh. Physics, you're a mass subject to impersonal forces that are deterministic. Biology, you are basically a flesh robot programmed by your genes to maximize reproductive self-interest. Economics, you are a rational actor seeking to maximize financial self-interest. All of them agreed on what it was to exist. Well, the new sciences contradict that. Quantum mechanics seems to violate the separation between self and other. If we're separate from the universe, then of course we want to control these indifferent or hostile external forces. And humanity's destiny becomes to become the lords and masters of nature and to transcend nature. And it's not working too well anymore. In economics, that translates into growth, the endless growth of the human realm. And we're learning that there's a limit to that. And we're learning that it's not an external universe out there, but that everything we do to this world, we're doing on some level to ourselves. That is a wound that we feel all the time and that we suffer from. That pain of existing in our culture that's so omnipresent, we don't even realize it, except when we're bored, you know? That feeling of, why does it hurt just to exist? When we're young, we have this knowledge that the world is supposed to be much more beautiful than what has been offered to us as normal. We understand that, but that expectation gets betrayed again and again and again, and to protect it, we develop cynicism. As our ecosystems fall apart, our political system, our educational system, healthcare system falls apart, things aren't working so well anymore, and it's a lot harder to fully believe in our stories. So we're moving into a different story of self, a different story of the world, a different story of the people. The self of interconnectedness, the self of inner beingness. One thing it means is that these tiny actions may have a significance beyond that we can understand. That logic of the heart that says, yeah, I know that this is a significant act and I know that everything I do is significant, no longer contradicts the logic of the mind, which had been the logic of separation. And what effect could you, one tiny little being, have with the puny force available to you when the powers that be have so much more force at their disposal? Every act that comes from the understanding of interconnection, of inner being, is a spiritual act and also a political act. By acting from a different story, we disrupt the psychic substructure of our mythology, and we offer an alternative. This is something that's eminently practical, and any time that we give somebody an experience that doesn't fit into the old story, it weakens that old story. It disrupts it. It could be an act of generosity. It could be an act of forgiveness. Anything that violates that understanding that we're separate and everyone's in it for themselves. Being in service to something larger than yourself. And I would offer that as the formula for stepping into the flow of synchronicity. You don't know how to get from here to there, but that thing larger than yourself does. And it arranges these synchronicities, being at the right place at the right time, being in flow. I think everyone's experienced that. And usually when you experience that, it's when your world is kind of falling apart and you're in this state of uncertainty, and then all things like start to flow and they start to work, right? And we can enter that state when we let go of the paradigm of control and bow into service to this thing larger than ourselves. And what is this thing? What is it that unifies all of these different things that we're committed to? Let's call it the more beautiful world our heart knows is possible. As you go about your life, in fact, right now, feel that part of you that knows that you are here in service, and ask yourself if you're ready to bow more deeply into that service. If you do it, I predict that you will experience an unexpected opportunity to act on that intention. And it'll be just at the edge of your courage, but not past it.
This is the new health green buzz rolling into town. James Maskell, so excited to introduce you to this man. He is on a mission to change the way we take care of ourselves and each other.
We're ready for some significant change, you know, but people haven't been able to make that change. For the last 8 years, we've been forced to buy health insurance from a small number of companies. 86% of costs in America, of healthcare costs, are actually driven by chronic disease. And we have a doctor network doing functional medicine and integrative medicine that is capable of reversing these diseases, getting people off drugs and keeping people well. That has to be the foundation for a future of healthcare, no matter who's paying. And we are starting the first non-denominational health cost sharing community to help people take care of each other and take care of themselves in a much more efficient way.
Great to be back here in Minnesota. Thanks everyone for being here this evening. It's a great crowd. I actually have come to really enjoy being in Minnesota, in Wisconsin, in this part of the world, and it's great to meet so many people here this evening, and to have a chance to connect with you. You know, listen to Charles Eisenstein's video at the beginning. You know, we're moving into a new story, and it's about community. And thank you. It takes effort to show up and be here, and I really appreciate it. So. The last 3 days, I drove here in that green bus from Salt Lake City. Now, if you happen to be a vegan, and you're the kind of vegan that doesn't like killing bugs, I would not recommend driving a bus that's essentially flat at the front across South Dakota, because you will kill millions of bugs. And I did, and I had to clean them all off today. But apart from that, it has been a really amazing experience just to, you know, have 3 days by myself, driving across the country and planning the second half of this tour. And I'm really excited about the second half, because you are going to hear today. You heard back in Sacramento where I gave that interview, we are planning on starting the first non-denominational health cost sharing community. That is happening, and that is happening later this year. It's an unstoppable force heading down a very steep hill, and it's going to be a very, very exciting next couple of months for myself and my wife, who are going to be in the bus. We got here tonight. We're going to be in Chicago in a couple days, and continuing on through the Midwest in September, which I've heard is the nicest time to come through here. I planned it like that, right? Am I right? Okay, good. So I'm excited to be here. So Tonight, we're going to talk about a new vision for healthcare, I'm going to be able to really showcase some practitioners and providers and innovators and agitators who are mainly from this part of the world who are doing incredible work to move healthcare forward and sort of tie it together into a story that helps you sort of get an idea of of why we're doing what we're doing. These are the sponsors for the tour. I want to share my appreciation for them. I also want to share my appreciation for Nutridyne, who's the sponsor for this event. Being able to partner with companies that are sort of integrated into the fabric of the local practitioner community definitely makes it easier for us to bring community together. So very appreciative for them as well. Now, in most cities, right, we come along and we have the most interesting innovators in the room, and they could be doctors, and maybe they shifted to a functional medicine practice, or maybe they got the bug a few years ago, or maybe they're on the leading edge. But here in Minnesota, you have people, and one person in particular, who has been fighting this fight for a long time and putting not only like their efforts and their time and their money behind integrated medicine and building it. And I'm really thrilled tonight to let you know that we have a special introduction speaker here. She is a visionary philanthropist. She is responsible for dragging Minnesota, kicking and screaming into, you know, this new era of healthcare. So it's my great pleasure to start off this evening to have an introductory address from, please welcome, Penny George.
I'm feeling good.
I'm actually here to learn, and I'm realizing that I'm standing between you and the content. And so I'm going to just say a little bit about the work that we've been doing, but I also wanted to say that I see Minnesota as really fertile ground for the transformation of healthcare. I mean, I think that's to the credit of all of you who are here. And for me, one of the best parts about this journey is the company I've gotten to keep. The best people are attracted to this work. And ever since I learned about functional medicine, I wanted to know more because I think it has an important role to play in progressive medicine. And I don't know as much about it as I want to, so I'm looking forward to the rest of the evening. Even though things are pretty much a mess nationally, I think we still have the opportunity locally to create the kind of healthcare that we want to have. And there are some favorable wins that are happening. For example, the Joint Commission, which is the body that certifies hospitals and other clinical settings, has said that they are requiring that all clinical settings have to offer non-pharmaceutical approaches to pain management, which is a really big deal. The NIH body that is responsible for research on integrative medicine, the National Center for Complementary and Integrative Medicine, has just chosen a new leader who's somebody who actually comes from within the world of integrative medicine, which is what my background is in that area, not professionally, but that's what I've been calling it all these years. And so I think that's really promising as well. The VA is moving very strongly toward whole person care. They have a number of different sites around the country where they're doing very, very innovative work. So I think there's a lot for us to feel encouraged about. My own introduction to this is that I was diagnosed with breast cancer, and I realized pretty quickly that while my care was, according to the highest standards, it was technically efficient, but holistically pretty insufficient. So I put together my own healing path and realized that there really is a lot that needs to be part of body, mind, spirit, community healing. And it wasn't the therapies that I did that I found so important. It really was the fact that I was in charge of my own sense of health, my own return to well-being, and I thought everybody deserves that. So that's sort of how I got sort of beginning to walk down this path, that we needed a medicine that was prepared to partner with people and to empower them, that the whole self-healing capacity wasn't being tapped into at all. And so that was 20 years ago. And I have learned a lot about some of the obstacles about trying to change large healthcare systems where the financial incentives are really perverse. There really is not anything in it for healthcare systems to help you be well or stay well. So I wanted to say that the work that I've done has been through the George Family Foundation, which my husband Bill and I founded in 1994, something like that. And my husband was CEO of Medtronic, and then he was chair of the board of Abbott Northwestern Hospital and Allina, and right now he's on the Mayo board, and that's where he is actually this evening. So he brings his own perspective to this and a fair amount more muscle to this work than I do, and still we've had a really hard time getting some of the changes that we've wanted to have to be sustainable. I want to recognize Gail Ober. Gail, raise your hand. Gail is president of the George Family Foundation, and literally we could not begin to do this work without Gail. We've been involved nationally and also locally. The national work of the George Family Foundation has been through something called the Brave Walk Collaborative, which was a collaboration of a number of individuals and small family foundations around the country that shared the same vision for the transformation of healthcare. And starting in 2002, for 12 years, we really worked to float all the boats, to work systemically, strategically. And some of the things that we did was we helped train a cadre of clinicians at Andy Weil's program in Arizona. We provided the infrastructure for the first ever practice-based research network. We had a two-hour public television special called The New Medicine. And we also supported the growth of the academic consortium. It's now called the Academic Consortium for Integrative Medicine and Health, from its original 8 schools, including the University of Minnesota, to now it's something like, 76 of the leading academic health centers in the country. So when we began, people were still talking about some of what we were talking about as being quackery. And nobody had ever heard of integrative medicine. And so I feel like that Bravewell didn't do it alone, but I think I take some satisfaction in the fact that it's more in the public consciousness now, the principles that we were working toward. Our local work has been mostly around two healthcare systems, Mayo and in particular Allina Health, and what became known as the Penny George Institute for Health and Healing has really led Allina to where it is now, which is they have publicly declared that their raison d'etre, their brand promise, is whole person care. Now, they still have to figure out what that means and how far they can go with it, but the good news about that is that they're paying for it. It's hard to raise money for integrative medicine, but Allina is not asking us to pay for that, and so they're doing it through their service lines, and so I have a meeting coming up shortly where they're going to talk about what their strategy for whole person care in oncology is, and then following that, they'll be doing it in CV, mother, baby, and neurology, so the neurosciences, I mean. The other satisfaction is the number of people who have been who tell me all the time that they have found help through the Penny George Institute, where they realize how much potential they have on their own to be optimally well, no matter where they are on the continuum from health to illness. And then the final thing I wanted to say about Allina is that the research on acupuncture in the emergency department that they did is very exciting. And they have made a commitment again through Abbott, in this case, their foundation is going to pay for the continuation of an acupuncturist on the ED in the emergency department, which is a big thing when you're thinking about opioid addiction and some of those issues. So we've come a long way, but our vision has also broadened and become bolder, which makes it more complicated. And I think one of the key strategies that needs to be part of it now that we didn't realize as much in the beginning is the importance of community-facing efforts that help people wherever they are optimize their own health and well-being and understand that self-care is the true primary care. And we're doing that in two ways. One is a program we just finished called the Catalyst Initiative, which was a three-year, $3 million initiative to identify and support grassroots efforts in the community, particularly around the healing from trauma. These are sort of health, self-healing initiatives, mind-body medicine in Indian country. There's an Islamic toolkit in mind-body practices. And we brought in curanderas through the Hennepin Health, and that was so successful that the Minneapolis Foundation has taken on the Catalyst Initiative. So if you know people who are interested in funding things, I think that would be a wonderful thing to support, because the Minneapolis Foundation has donors, but they're also looking for more people to support this initiative. And then most recently, the George Family Foundation has partnered with the YMCA of the Greater Twin Cities, which is the third largest Y in the country, and the one that's looked to nationally for innovation. And we've partnered with them to create the Center for Wellbeing, the George Center for Wellbeing, that's on the Skyway level of Gavaday, which is between 6th and 7th on Nicollet. They've remodeled that building. And in addition to offering new holistic services to Y members, it's also a platform for developing programs that can hopefully go throughout the country. They already have the diabetes prevention program that was developed, I think, through Medicaid and Medicare's innovation, whatever. But they're also going to be doing some things in cardiovascular and other, perhaps be a wonderful place for small groups to self-form around things like the Whole 30 or the Terry Walls protocol for recovering from multiple sclerosis. The reason that we partnered with the Y is because, first of all, people, when they come to the Y, have agency. And they come expecting to have to do something for themselves. And also, because anybody can afford it. So we thought that this was a really important thing. So I just wanted to say that these things are ongoing and that I'm glad to be here. And thank you very much for asking me.
Thank you so much, Penny. And I hope everyone in the room, you know, you could just see how dedicated Penny and her husband have been for many years. And, you know, I guess what I wanted to do tonight and why I wanted to invite you, Penny, to be here is just to show that, like, there are young people that care about this as well, right? There's a lot of people that care about this. Well, there are people, a lot of people really care. And, you know, as we've gone around the country, you know, to just come to these kind of events and just see how passionate people are about healthcare transformation is really, really exciting. And it's been catalyzed by, I know, decades of work on the front lines. And ultimately, I think what we're talking about is it's time for a new story. And you know, I know, Penny, you came into this world with your own, you know, your own health issue. And many people come into this world because they have their own health issue. It's not dealt with by doctors. And then they have to go and find another way. And they end up coming with this real powerful story of healthcare transformation. And on this tour, we're looking to capture those stories. Because what I found from 13 years of working in this space, a lot of times those stories are like in a chart in a doctor's office that no one will ever see. And that doesn't really help anyone else to learn from that story. Because we're still in the process of developing the science that will sort of convince everyone. But while we're in this space between stories where many people know that it's real and have experienced it firsthand, but it's not been widespread adoption into the system, we need to find ways to make and create and share those stories. So if you see outside in the booth, and if you're watching at home, anyone can do this, you can participate in this new story, which is essentially to share your story in 60 seconds. All the way through this tour, we've been collecting them. You can do it outside in 60 seconds to share your story. So here's the instructions, and there's a card outside that you can get, but you can record the 60-second smartphone on your smartphone, share it on social media with hashtag new story. Hashtags are amazing, right? In November, you will literally be able to put in hashtag new story into whatever social you want and see all of these stories written there. So if you're sitting here because you've had that story and your story has only been told, you know, over the dinner table to a few people, I think it's time to share that in a more powerful way. And so one of the, you know, we've given some prompts on the back end, you know, new, and the word new really speaks to the fact that typically with all these stories, there's a moment of intuition that kicks in, that I'm sort of going in the wrong direction and we need to go in a different direction. And that moment of intuition is really, really powerful. And so that's why we've chosen the idea new story. So check it out. And if you've got something to contribute to that, that would be really powerful. And one thing we're going to talk about here tonight is about two things, right? What are the goals here? The goals are, how do we keep a population healthy? and how do we massively reduce the costs of healthcare? Right? Those are the two goals, and just think about those two things all the way through to tonight's content. Because the truth is, people think that healthcare costs are made up from like accident and emergency and all that kind of stuff, but 86% of healthcare costs arise from lifestyle-driven chronic disease. We got way more of it than anywhere else in the world. America invented it, we're exporting it, but we're also ahead in the solutions. Because I'm here to tell you today that no one else really knows how to deal with it either anywhere else around the world. So we can be part of the solution because we were just earlier in getting the problems and reacting to the problems. So what I'm going to share tonight is essentially our thesis for new health. And I'm going to start with this quote. So I would say that up till about 5 years ago, I was sort of like an activist guy, right? Where I was angry about what I saw. I was like the weird kid that grew up with natural medicine, and all the family and friends were pretty healthy. And so to see, you know, such human potential being wasted by lack of health was really frustrating. And so I was angry, and I would like sign petitions and march and stuff like that, and didn't really get where I needed to go. And then I saw this quote from Bucky Fuller. He says, "You never create change by fighting the existing reality. To create change, you build the new system that makes the existing system obsolete." And from the moment that I heard that quote, first of all, I put it on the bottom of my email, right? So that everyone would know that this is what James is all about, and this was basically what I'm going to be about. And for the last 5 years, it's all I've been thinking about. Because hopefully it's obvious to all of you who care about this, that in healthcare, you can see that this is actually like really possible. And the best thing that integrative and functional medicine has going for it is that it's really good at chronic disease. And so building a new chronic disease system that makes the existing system obsolete is possible. And now I see not only is possible, is actually going to happen, and it's happening right now. And we're going to talk about that here this evening. And I want to share with you a sort of a structure of how we believe how we're going to create this thing. And I'm going to start with, if this is familiar to you, it's because in May 2017, we did a functional forum here, and that was actually the first time that I showed this idea. And for those of you, you know, if you're watching at home and if you're watching the functional forum, this is actually a functional forum. It's actually called the Evolution of Endocrinology, even though, you know, Penny is not an endocrinologist. But what we're going to be talking about today is endocrinology. You know, it's going to be a theme. And why is it a good theme for chronic disease? Is because the one thing you know about the endocrine system is that it's connected to every other system. Right? The endocrinologist cannot operate in isolation. If he doesn't read the gastroenterology journals or the neurology journals, he's going to be stuck in this weird like silo where his system controls every other system, but he doesn't know anything about any of the other systems. That is insane. Right? So what we're going to talk about tonight is through all the speakers you're going to hear from here are going to talk about it through this context. And what we've created is sort of like what I call the five C's of healthcare transformation. And when we came here last time in 2017, I shared this for the first time. And back then the plan was, hey, doctors and practitioners, go do it. Go make this in your clinic wherever you are. But last year, and you know, as things came about, I couldn't rationalize that being the only plan. It was like, made me, you know, I had to like take more clear action, and that's what's led us here. So new health will be using these five C's. So the first thing, and you're going to hear from Pilar next, is about transforming the culture, right? We have to have a fundamentally different culture, and Pilar generously came in at the last minute to speak here. She spoke in Salt Lake City. She's actually from here, but did the best talk of the whole tour, so I was like, you got to come back and do it. So she's going to be taking us through culture. Then we're going to be talking about community. You know, Penny talked about community. And you can see, I think with all of these, I just want you to see that each one of these things, as we go in, gets incrementally more expensive, right? So at the beginning, we're dealing with the cheapest things possible and the most scalable things possible. And as we go closer and closer in, you'll see that it gets more and more expensive. But that's because that's part of the thesis, is that giving functional medicine in the way that it's delivered to everyone right now, even healthy people, doesn't make any sense. Giving everyone in the country a stool test that costs $2,000 is not a plan for reducing healthcare costs or healthcare transformation, right? So we have to do it. So everyone can participate in the culture. Community is the next thing, because community-based initiatives, and we're going to have Dr. Kara Parker talk about her work in delivering functional medicine to the underserved through group visits and the power of community to transform relationships. We'll get into that. Then we're going to talk about coaching. Coaching is a new brand of healthcare. You know, coaching didn't come from medicine. Coaching came from business, where they realized that behavior change was important. Well, behavior change wasn't important in medicine until they realized that chronic disease is being driven from it, and now we need behavior change. So coaching is coming into medicine in a big way, and we're basing our strategy in New Health on health coaches, on putting health coaches on the front lines of healthcare and creating healthcare transformation through behavior change. The fourth is care. So this is where the functional medicine comes in, right? So how do we actually, if you can't get better from taking on a new culture through community initiatives and through coaching, and there's still things that are going on that are stopping you from being healthy, okay, then you probably maybe a $250 Dutch test might be a good idea at that time. And you're going to have Mark Newman, the founder of Dutch Test, talk about how they're making functional medicine testing affordable through that. And then right in the middle is cost sharing. And I'm going to talk about that at the end, because Penny said something that I hope you're all listening to. And it's about perverse incentives. And perverse incentives are so rife in American medicine that it takes a British guy to come here and show you what's up. Because it's super embarrassing, and I might swear later, so prepare yourself for that. I've been swearing across the country to different degrees. It didn't go down well in Utah. That was not good. But I feel like Minnesota will be okay with it. We'll see what I crack out later. Anyway, so this is what we're going to be going through this evening, just to prepare you for what you're going to be hearing. And I hope just to think about all the way through. I want you to think about the creation of health and the saving of money, because those two things have to go hand in hand, right? My daughter was on the first half of this trip. She's 5 years old. In 13 years, it's predicted if we continue on the same way, 1 in 2 children will have autism. And autism costs $3.2 million for each child for their care for their whole life. So she's going to be responsible for 1.6 if she's lucky. At this moment, it's 1 in 30. So all of you are responsible for $100,000. You feel good about that? That's just autism. There's many, many chronic diseases that are going to bleed this country dry financially. Where did all the money go for the last 30 years? Why have there been no growth in wages for everyone? It's all healthcare costs, right? Aetna's been sucking it all up. I'll show you all later. I'll show you the stats. It's a fact. I almost swore, but I'm not going to. I'll save it for later. Okay, culture. Pilar Gerasimo, the founder of Experience Life, a savant who knew 18 years ago that medicine was going to go this way, started a magazine called Experience Life 15 years before everyone was talking about functional medicine, you know, and knew about health coaching in 2001. She is going to teach you about the way of the healthy deviant. Please welcome Pilar Gerasimo.
With stripper music. I'm actually going to talk to you about really what I am as a weirdo. And the deviant is a term that you guys probably all really associate mostly with weirdness. Strange people that don't fit in and don't follow the rules. And deviance is a term that, while it has a negative connotation in our culture, is a fairly straightforward definition. One that differs from a norm, especially a person whose behavior and attitudes differ from accepted social standards. Well, it makes you kind of wonder, in the culture that we're living in, where so many people are sick and the perverse incentives exist, like, why are we living the way we live and how do we continue living this way? So what is healthy deviance? I basically describe it as a willingness to defy unhealthy norms. And those are the norms that are the most pervasive in our society today. But it's kind of troubling that if you want to fit in and go along, like most of us are raised to do, you're going to end up unhealthy. So the healthy deviance is really about building autonomy and resilience. I'm going to talk a little bit about that tonight. So to do this, I need 100 volunteers, which is a lot to ask in a room this size. So I have decided to press you into service. Those of you who have a number in front of you from 100 to 1, you've got little cards at the beginning I may have handed out about this size. I would ask for you to stand. Everyone with a number from 100 to 1. there'll be a lot of you. Excellent, thank you. And I do promise this will be the easiest volunteer job most of you will ever have, and I will not be making you do anything terribly embarrassing. Most of you, anyway. Okay, so right now in our culture, 50% of U.S. adults have already been diagnosed with at least one chronic illness. Many of them have been diagnosed with more, because as you know, they tend to kind of run together, right? You get one, and then another, and another. So everyone with a number from 1 through 50, you can just sit down. I told you it would be easy. Back half of the room, just gone. Just cut a wide swath through the U.S. adult population there. It actually turns out that, well, this skipped ahead, 66% of U.S. adults are overweight or obese. And we know now that a lot of overweight and obese conditions, they are attached in many cases to chronic diseases. They're predecessors to them. So anybody with a number up to 66, you can sit down. Lost a few more of you. 70% take at least one prescription drug on a daily basis. This is based on studies that were published in the Mayo Clinic Proceedings Journal. And they think that this number is reasonably accurate. It has to still get studied. But at least 70% of U.S. adults take at least one prescription drug every single day. And again, many take more. By the time you're 65, you're likely to be taking 5 on a regular basis. And we know that the interactions and strange things that happen when we're taking prescription drugs are some of the leading causes of death. So anybody with a number up to 77, you can take a seat. And you see, somehow, the dwindling of the crowd. It's kind of getting serious. Only a few of you left standing. It gets worse, though, because 80% of U.S. adults are suffering from some type of emotional or mental chronic strain. They're not flourishing or thriving. So it might be depression or anxiety or a behavior or a mood disorder. But that means only 20% of U.S. adults are in a good place mentally and emotionally. So everybody with a number up to 80, you can sit down. Last few. And this would be bad enough, right? Like, what kind of society produces that? There are like 20% of us doing okay? But this is the crazy part. According to this study, again, published in the Mayo Clinic Proceedings, 97.3% of U.S. adults are not practicing even the most basic healthy habits that are required for ongoing health and well-being. 97.3%. And what they counted were things like eating a reasonably healthy diet, which they define as, of course, according to the USDA nutrition guidelines, which is not all that healthy, right? Also, exercising about 30 minutes a day on average, 5 days a week. Sort of moderate exercise, taking a walk. Not smoking is one of them, the other one, which is an important one. And then maintaining a healthy body composition. Now, they consider that a habit or a behavior, and I think it's really an outcome of behaviors or habits, right? It's like what you do on a daily basis that dictates your body mass. But those are the four that they counted. Now, it's interesting, what they did not count are some really important factors like sleep and stress and social connection, which we now know to be actually as or more important than the factors they did count, which then kind of leaves you wondering, what if you counted all of those things? What if you actually factored in the nutrition, the movement, the stress, the sleep, the social connection, the smoking, and the body composition? I would guess, and we don't have this figure, but it seems hard for me to imagine it could possibly be more than 1% of U.S. adults. So 97.3% of you can sit down. I'll say anybody with a number up to 97, 98. And then let's just figure maybe the rest of you, we got one person standing. We should have, yeah, so we'll say maybe 1%. You guys can sit down too. Thank you for having healthy habits though. Or at least some healthy habits, a few healthy habits. No, no. Oh, no, no. This always happens. This last poor person who's by herself standing here in front of a room of people who are seated for some crazy reason, she wants to sit down. What do you think? What does it mean to live in a society like this, where we just cut through 97.5 or so percent of the population, and then another few percent with an educated guess? If this is the reality of it, there's something absolutely nuts, right? So I would think that if you ask yourself what kind of society produces results where one poor individual is standing here, the only answer that's possible is a sick society. And I love this quote by Jiddu Krishnamurti that says, it is no measure of health to be well-adjusted to a profoundly sick society. But it's also really important to acknowledge that it is no walk in the park to be maladjusted to your society, as this fair lady will say. So, like, how does it feel for you to be standing there on your own by yourself?
Kind of lonely.
Yeah, kind of lonely. A little socially awkward.
Right.
Yeah. Yep, you are. You're encountering the experience of the healthy deviant. which is this odd person out. Now, you also have to think about, what did she have to do differently than 97, 98, 99% of the population on a daily basis? What did this person have to do from the moment that she gets up until the moment she goes to bed at night, and probably after that, to stay to sleep, sleep well? A lot of weird behaviors that go against the grain. You swim against a tide, you dance to your own drum, and that is exhausting. And it's demoralizing, and it's not something that we take into consideration when we're busy giving people diets and exercise programs and even really well-designed elimination diets and programs and asking them to think about how to read labels and perform these miracles that we want them to do in the face of resistance. So my argument is basically, first of all, we should acknowledge this person and give her a hand. Let's give her a hand. Thank you. Our healthy diva, now you may have a seat. But I also think it's really important, a message to take home to our practices, to our work, to our families, and really take home to our own hearts, that if we struggle to make these healthy decisions on a daily basis, it isn't just that it's a little inconvenient, it's that it's requiring what amounts to a socially deviant or revolutionary act, day in, day out, week in, week out. And I believe we have to start acknowledging and accommodating for that in our solutions. When we talk about community care, when we talk about shifting the system, the providers and are also having to be healthy deviants, which is not easy. You know, those of you who practice medicine either without a license or with a license that would like you to do something different, this is sort of what it feels like to me, is that there's this big, amorphous, unhealthy culture that's constantly kind of trying to suck us in like an immune system, and you might pop out of it for a minute, and then it's just like coming along behind you. You know, you're on your path for a little while, and it gets harder. So to be the person on the outside of that system is a really big challenge. So I have suggested, I've got a bunch of solutions. I'm writing a book called The Healthy Deviant right now, but I'll just give you the short form manifesto. And this is not rich on specifics, but I can provide them for you. First of all, subvert the unhealthy default reality. If the big amorphous thing is out there doing its trouble, we have to actively oppose it and disrupt it, or it will only continue to grow. So being willing to be the person who does the disruptive thing, creates the challenging act, is really important. The second is calling out the crazy when we see it, and it is around us all the time. I still get newspaper clippings that are all about low-fat diets and having, you know, diabetics eat a lot of fat-free bagels for breakfast, and that is crazy. So are the magazine covers with bikini bodies that say, you know, do this workout and get this lady's butt. I mean, it's nuts, but we just let it go, and I think we have to start actively calling out the unrealistic body types, the crazy suggestions, and the dysfunctional advice that are being offered by a lot of the most authoritative experts and sources in this country. The third is we have got to make it more fun, because right now, being a healthy person is a slog. You should do this. You have to do that. You have to do that again. You can't do that. You can't do this. You can't eat that. No, no, no. And then we start fighting with each other. Oh, you're paleo? I'm vegan. Sorry. Oh, you're vegan? I'm paleo. Whoa. And we start to kind of exclude and make more and more marginalized the people who are making healthy choices different than us. Everybody has to kind of experiment and figure it out. And believe me, I have really strong opinions, but I don't want to live a life of a healthy deviant all by myself. So I think we have to find ways of making it more inclusive and more fun for everybody, so that healthy living is a party that everybody wants to join. And I will kind of leave you with this quote. One of my favorite healthy deviants, another just a savanti type, Frank Zappa, said, without deviation, there is no progress. There can be no progress. And I think that, James, you know, the work you guys are doing in pushing the limits, in this case, in a big green bus going driving across the country, it's a crazy deviant act, but it does represent progress. So those of you who are making even some healthy deviant behaviors on a daily basis, give yourselves a round of applause, first of all. Thank you for participating. Thank you for being part of the Living Infographic. And if you want to find out more, I gave you the website, thehealthydeviant.com. You can take a quiz there that tells you where you fall right now on the healthy deviant spectrum, as I call it, from one end to the other. And that's kind of fun. And if you want to find out more about me, you can connect with me through social channels or my websites. And thank you so much for having me. And I'd love to say, too, it's an honor to be here with Penny George, who is a mentor of mine and a great friend. Thank you for everything you've done to get us this far. Thanks, James.
All right, so we're going to start a truly healthy deviant culture, right? New Health is going to have it's going to be a fun party for people who want to be healthy. I'll tell you this, right? Healthcare, being healthy, has to become cool. That's what has to happen. Now, if you think that's impossible, how cool was tech 15 years ago, right? Technology wasn't cool. It was a bunch of guys in hoodies, like, going over. It still kind of is that. But, like, you know, Zuckerberg's not really cool, but he's got $1 billion, kind of cool. But you know what I mean, right? Tech, sort of, you know, the view of techie people went from being, you know, being lame to being cool. And we're in that same transition. It's happening for doctors who are doing integrated medicine, and it's going to happen for the people themselves. New health's going to be cool. I can guarantee you of that. It's going to be fun. It's going to be awesome. We're going to learn from all this and make it a fun, cool place to be part of. And, you know, there are people who are making it cool. So if you've been out to the merch booth, this is the best book that I think is a transformative agent. It's called How to Make Disease Disappear. You talked about the Whole 30 a minute ago. Actually, Penny, you talked about Whole 30 and groups surrounding it. You know, this is a book that many, many doctors in our community just have in their lending library, and they're like, hey, you wanna be healthy? Read this, How to Make Disease Disappear. It's got a punchy title. Dr. Rangan Chatterjee is doctor in the house in the UK. He reverses chronic disease on TV in front of 5 million people. Everyone saw it happen. This is like a sort of a step-by-step guide to reversing chronic disease, and everyone should read it. And, you know, Rangan's a cool dude. At some point in the future, when we have our first big new event, he's going to come and he's going to do Johnny Be Good from the stage, and everyone's going to think how damn cool it is. All right, so visit the merch booth. Buddies in My Belly is cool too. It's my daughter's favorite book. And at the Boulder Functional Forum last month, you know, the person who wrote it, Sarah Morgan, said something really amazing, which is that if you give it, like, yeah, you might have a granddaughter that needs to listen to it, or a daughter that you want to give it to, but the cool thing is whoever reads it to the kid learns it too, right? So you've got a son or a daughter or someone younger in the family who has kids that isn't healthy, and you don't want to tell them that directly. Oh, I bought you this book to read to the kid. It's devious. But that's what we're all about. That's what we're all about here at New Health, Devious. All right, community. I want to talk about community next, because ultimately, this is what I'm all about. I was born in a community. The only thing we've really done with the Functional Forum is created these communities. And ultimately, I think it's the most powerful force of health creation. So this article came from The Guardian. Frome in Somerset, which is near where my mum lives, in England, has seen a dramatic fall in emergency hospital admissions since it began a collective project to combat isolation. Here are lessons for the rest of the country. On the way here, by the way, if anyone wants to go to a place where it's hard to be, where you have to be a deviant to be healthy, just drive all the way across Highway 90 from here to the other side of South Dakota. It's very difficult to find a healthy meal on that route. But I will say that I stopped in Albert Lea, Minnesota. Does anyone know why I might stop in Albert Lea, Minnesota? Yes, over there. The Blue Zone, exactly. Right, so when Dan Buettner came up with the idea of the Blue Zone, and he looked at all the healthy behaviors from all across the for these healthy places, he went to Albert Lea, Minnesota, and implemented them in 2009. It was a great success. I got these stats that I think there was a 60% increase in how people felt about the town. There was, dun dun dun, a 40% reduction in healthcare costs. 40% by putting in bike lanes and changing the supermarket and a few other changes, community interventions. Here's the thing, and this is why we're going to get into cost sharing in a minute. Who benefited from that 40% reduction? Did the people themselves who took the action reduce? Did their health insurance premiums in Albert Lea go down by 40%? Hell no. Aetna benefited 40%. Right? Aetna benefited 40% because their claims went down 40%, but people are still paying the same insurance because they don't have an Albert Lea rate. What we're going to talk about later, and this is just a tune, why community and cost sharing go so well together. Imagine a system where the people who do the work get financially incentivized for doing it. What do you think about that? This is a much better way to do this presentation. I'm getting claps in the minute. I'm going to have a standing ovation by the end. When I start swearing, you guys are going to get into it. All right, so then I want to talk about this. So we started the tour, and then this came out in the New York Times. It was talking about the MOI, The Moai is the coolest thing ever, right? This comes from the Blue Zones. So in Okinawa, Japan, people get put into, by their parents, groups of five families. Five families become a micro community that take care of each other spiritually, sometimes financially. They cook together, they eat together. This is a system that keeps people healthy. It keeps people living into their ninth decade that costs nothing. Actually costs, it's way positive, because cooking spaghetti bolognese for 10 people costs less than cooking it for 2 people. Right? And we're going to talk about that too. So community is a significant power, and we're going to access all of this in New Health. We're going to do community batch cooking. We're going to put people into Moais. If you become a member of New Health, you're going to go and get 4 of your healthy friends to be in too, and you're going to be your own little Moai, and you're going to keep your health costs down for you, and everyone's going to do it. So it's going to be, you've already got a party right there, right? You don't need to create your own party. You've got a party locally of friends. Community is truly the guru of the future. And it's not just the guru of the future, it's the guru of the right now. Thich Nhat Hanh is still alive, just. And I want him to see this come to fruition. So, our sponsors in the community section is Dry Farm Wines. Now, it does seem a little strange to have a wine sponsor for a health thing, but I will tell you this. One, the Dry Farm method makes it keto compliant, right? So that it doesn't spike your blood sugar. And the Dry Farm method is actually really awesome. But two, if you start a meetup group, right, in, you know, for our functional forum meetups, and you get more than 20 people to come, they'll send you a free case of wine, Dry Farm Wines. Actually, let me just see, who in here runs a functional forum meetup somewhere? This crew, where are you guys doing it? Edina, right? Eau Claire, anyone else over here? These are the people, anyone else that I'm missing? Yeah, where are you guys?
Stillwater,
exactly, look. Moais of health practitioners getting together once a month. You know, one of the things that we've heard so much is that, you know, functional medicine doctors have had to go through this journey from being weird to cool. It hasn't happened. We're still at 90% weird, right? But one of the things I will say is that I have heard time and time again that practitioners have the confidence to practice this type of medicine because they have a community of other practitioners to speak to when it doesn't go exactly like Mark Hyman told them it would, right? When the diabetes doesn't mysteriously go away after he gets them off carbs for 3 weeks, right? What do I do? What's the next step? Is this real? You know, whatever, there's other people there like, no, did you think about this, whatever, and it gives you that confidence. That's why we have to have these communities. I'm going to say one more thing about community. I met on my travels a marine biologist, and he told me about how mussels seed. Mussels, the food. I guess they're not the food, the animal. Some people eat them. My daughter likes the mollusk. It's a mollusk. There you go. Savant. So, when it's seeding, when resources are plentiful, it seeds in just a random pattern. You have a few here, there's a few there, it's all over the place, ones, twos, here's. If they have to seed in a space where there's limited resources, limited amount of food for them to eat, how do they grow? In clumps, in communities. Because why? They need the positive feedback loop of a community to survive. I don't know if you've noticed, but the resources in this country are scarce and only getting scarcer. We need community to survive. We need community to thrive. Health insurance is a fundamentally isolating proposition because it's just you. And you think, oh, if it's just me, if I get hit by a car, I'm totally screwed. Right? And so you have to have health insurance. Community-based structures, that's why it's important. So we're going to learn from the mollusks from now on. All right. So, next, it's not stripper music. It's Michael Bublé. Anyway, to talk to you more about how community is being actualized to deliver functional medicine to the masses, please welcome Dr. Kara Parker.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody. I am honored to be sharing about community tonight, and I'm definitely going to call my next group visit something about healthy deviants. I think that's a great thing. I hope you don't mind if I borrow it, Pilar. And I would like to also publicly thank Penny and Bill and the Catalyst Foundation. You sponsored work for us to learn from Henry Emmons and Resilience Program, at Hennepin County Medical Center. And that work formed the background of much of what I'm doing in these group visits programs. So you very directly actually helped what I'm going to be speaking about tonight. So I'm a physician taking standard insurance. I work through Hennepin County Medical Center, which is our county hospital here in the Twin Cities. And did I do that, James? Okay. To the right. That was the right. Down, over. Come and help me. Technology assistance, thank you. All right.
Just go that
way. Okay. So I work through Whittier Clinic in Minneapolis. Some of you who were at the functional forum in the winter a couple of years ago might recognize this lobby space. It was where we ate, actually, when we hosted a functional forum. And shortly thereafter, we got grant funding and capital funding to put these glass modular walls in this large, underutilized lobby. And this is where we do our group visits work from. Group visits are increasing across the country, as well as in our system, for very good reason. There are a number of benefits that I hope to share and inspire you about this evening and have you think about your own systems and your own work with patients. I do have a MOAB with my colleagues. All of us in our integrative health department are doing group visits now, as well as some of our residents. And you can see some of the topics that we're doing. So group visits are accessible. And I'm talking to several of you this evening as we gathered. One of the issues with having more to offer than the standard of care is that you become sought after and practices close very quickly. Seeing participants in a functional medicine model and having extended visits, there's only so many hours in the day that you have that you can see patients. And so a great way to extend your practice and to give access to more people and to share your knowledge is by gathering people and doing it in a more efficient way. Interestingly, talking about healthcare financing, we gear our group visits toward more of the underserved and at-risk population, our charity care, Medicaid, and at-risk Medicare patients. And their deductible is nominal, $0 to $5. But if a privately insured person wants to come to a group visit and they haven't met their deductible yet, they get up to a $300 bill for every group visit. And if you have a series of eight, that's not expected and it's not fair for people who want to come try to improve their health and see a physician in the system to be billed that high and be responsible to pay that. So there's a lot of room for innovation and the types of thinking that's happening here in the space of group visits. Group visits are extremely efficient. I love to share this moment with our administrators and our executive team, my colleagues, my chief. This was 22 patients gathered, two languages. We had a beautiful and meaningful time together. And I was done with my charts before the visit was over. So, you know, 2 hours together, 22 patients, whether you are concierge, private pay, fee-for-service, or billing insurance, you really can leverage the efficiency of your practice while adding so much benefit. Group visits are also able to be very comprehensive, and with a functional medicine upstream personalized approach, there is so many factors to consider as you're dealing with people. So you really can, in 2 hours over multiple weeks, extend the time and go in depth into the upstream factors that impact health. So if you're talking about endocrine balance in the endocrine system, and you want to work with patients on that, you could gather people around Hashimoto's thyroiditis and do 10 sessions and go very deep. You could gather people around diabetes. I'm seeing some acknowledgement here. You could gather people with adrenal fatigue, insulin function, metabolic syndrome, so many things that you can do and be very deep and comprehensive addressing the upstream factors that you just don't have time in a one-on-one visit to do. Group visits, in my opinion, should be very educational. There is so much fantastic information about health, And people value being one-on-one with a practitioner, asking their personal questions about their medical issues. So you can watch a webinar, you can be part of a blog, you can search the internet, you can read a book, but when you're one-on-one with a practitioner who has your medical history at hand, and you can ask your personal questions, that's really important. Patients value that. If you're thinking about endocrine balance, as I said, there's a number of ways that you can spin and educate. And sometimes what you're talking about is kind of disturbing. So in this particular picture, we're talking about toxins in the environment and how they wash over our genetics and are as important as our genetic SNPs, maybe even more important, our lifestyle and toxins. And so they're contemplating toxins here, and they look a little disturbed. So good facilitation. My coordinator, facilitator, stands them up, gets them in a power stance, and we start talking about solutions, their solutions. How do you eat organic on a budget? I'll go to Aldi's, oh, these food shelves, Sisters of Camelot. How do you filter your air? Well, I use my Caddy Waver, and I got a filter, and here's how you do it. How do you filter your water? So people becoming empowered to bring forward their own solutions. Okay? I wanted to mention that all of the pictures are of participants in our group visits, and they've all signed waivers and given their verbal acknowledgement to use their images for education for people to learn about group visits. So I thank them for that. Other skills important to health and important to endocrine system balance, mindfulness, mind-body activities. This group did not look like this when they walked in the door. And so we sit them down, and before we even share, after we get vitals and do a brief physical and have them fill out forms, if we're talking about a particular thing like a sleep questionnaire, we go right into this together. And that shifts how much they can bond, how much they can learn, and the healthy choices that they'll make if they can do it from a relaxed state. Other skills that are important for health, movement. And movement, you know, you just said it, movement is not a skill that everyone chooses to do on a regular basis. Not everybody's comfortable in their bodies. So we begin our movement mindfully, slowly, and help people to be in the flow with their body. In thinking about endocrine, as we're doing this together, I might pipe in and say, hey, did you know that doing interval walking helps reduce cortisol and optimize DHEA and testosterone, important hormones for your body? Or that doing regular non-intense exercise changes how your body deals with cortisol. It's less toxic. So you use every opportunity when gathering people to make it a teaching and learning moment. Cooking can be added to any topic that you're doing, obviously, as a basis for health. And this is not a commercial kitchen. This is our little glass modular walls in our lobby. We don't have a sink. We don't have a refrigerator. And we have worked with partnerships to get this to about $20 a group visit, using as much as we can organic food. So if we're going to talk about endocrine balance, we could cook recipes that are low glycemic, and talk with participants, what does that mean? What's a low glycemic versus a high glycemic food? We could gather women in perimenopause and talk about hormone balancing foods, fiber and lignans and things like that. We could gather Hashimoto's and talk about foods with high zinc and selenium and cook some recipes and hand out a cookbook. So lots of skills to be built that are important to the new medicine and to building community. And then you can take that out to the streets and bring, you know, we gather people, and after we do our vitals and physical and check in, we go out in the community and we learn how to shop the perimeter of a grocery store, standard grocery store, and say, where's the food here that is going to support our health? The new medicine, including in-group visits, is empowering. It's turning the agency for health over to participants. So we throw topics up on the wall and let people vote about what's most important for them to learn. And within the group visit, we give participants lots of choice as to where they'd like it to go. Part of functional medicine is, of course, the patient's story. And part of the new medicine is to give that story back to the patient and let them retell their story and where they would like that story to go. This is our graceful aging group visit, where participants make a vision board of their health from past to future. And of course, by nature, group visits are supportive. The lack of social connection, as we all know, is as important as all those lifestyle factors. You talked about that, Pilar, that was even left out of the literature, or left out of that study you were talking about, but it's very much in the literature about how important social connection is. And thinking about endocrine, how important social connection is to cortisol balance. It actually helps, that having a sense of being socially connected helps your cortisol to function better. Participants talk about, even if they have friends or employment or a church or sports or kids and feel socially connected, they don't necessarily have a place to work on their health. And so group visits offer a health community where people can sit together and be witnesses to each other in an unconditional way. And it is amazing the diversity of groups that we have gathered and who has been touched and supported by others. It's just been really beautiful to witness. And the new medicine is demonstrative. So if we're going to talk about a hormone web, why don't we make a web? And let's act it out and get our bodies moving and learn by doing. And we honor the wisdom of participants. The patient at the bottom right was severely fatigued after a prolonged upper respiratory infection, and we did an adrenal stress index on him. He was adrenally fatigued. He got herbs, he got nutrients, he got therapeutic rest, but he said, "No offense, Dr. Parker, I'm sure that helped, but actually talking to this participant and hearing the what for and following her advice is really what helped me make a final shift." So group visits are not a replacement for one-on-one care, but people need more than what we can do in one-on-one care. And group visits, by design, can be restorative. What is the endocrine balance of these participants before and after this session? Two of them are residents, and I routinely have residents working with me, our family medicine residents, and they come out of it saying, "That is the most relaxed I have ever felt since I started residency." And then they feel empowered to continue it and to keep practicing and keep trying. And they've started supporting each other to do this now. I would like to see a Dutch test after this group visit, right? And to that point, we got to think about our providers too and create a medicine where the actual practice of medicine is a delight, where you get to share joy, eat healthy food, have a mind-body experience, teach in meaningful ways, and watch participants transform. And medicine and endocrine balance is nothing without gratitude. Our group visit participants are our biggest donors to our lending library, and they commonly bring in things to share to their medical visits. This is a vision board that one of our groups created, and I think it exemplifies some of the best aspects of a medicine that we all would like to be a part of. My group visit coordinator and I and our team, our integrative health team, have created a group visit handbook, a group visit guide, and they include instructional videos. It's in the final stages of editing, so not quite ready yet. But because it is grant-funded, it will be available at very nominal cost, and we hope to make it available for free. So if you're interested, my email's up here. Feel free to contact me. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Parker. Not only showcasing the future of healthcare right there, but doing it in perfect new health green. You can come on the bus later and with it. All right. So Wasn't that awesome? Like, just look how people enjoy that. Like, that is the future right there. Okay, so I just want to share, in a minute when I get to the cost sharing and I start swearing, I'm going to talk about that $300, because that, we're going to come in and back in a minute. I will just say, on Wednesday, speaking at the Chicago event is Dr. Lara Salia. And she's in Monroe, Wisconsin, which is apparently the cheese capital of Wisconsin. Cheese is the cheese. I'm going to the cheese days. I'm going to eat some cheese. It's not next week. But anyway, she decided to do a cash group visit, $30 a person. She could fit 18 chairs in the front of her office and does an 18-person cash group visit, $30 a person. She's making $540 for that time, right? So that's a good for the practitioner there, but it's $30 each. And in that time, you go through and create your functional medicine matrix. To create the functional medicine matrix with a functional medicine doctor, just multiply an hour and a half by their hourly rate, and you see how much it's going to cost to do it for you. Doing that in a community setting reduces the cost for everyone, empowers everyone, and you leave with one of the IFM food plans, right? She's created something spectacular for cash. That, you know, the chances of getting billed for $300 versus just paying $30 cash in a world of high deductible healthcare is insane. So there are people innovating outside the system and inside the system, and that's the future of where it's going. So the evolution of medicine, Dr. Salia's training is available inside our practice accelerator. We also created this program called the PMI. There is actually someone in this room right here, PMI participant. We spoke earlier. The PMI, which we're going to be re-releasing, was a way for people, like some people get passionate after they reverse their chronic disease and want to become a health coach because it's an easy way to get involved in the movement. But there are a lot of people that reverse their chronic disease that have no desire to be any sort of clinician at all. And so we created this thing called a practice marketing implementer, where you could go and essentially work for a practice and help them market, help them set up these group visits, right? Help them organize this kind of stuff. Does the doctor have time to do it all? No, but you could just have someone else who cares to do it. Health coach could do it super easy, which takes us on to my next phase. We are connecting along this tour. I know some of you have already said, but if you are a physician or a nurse practitioner interested in being part of our New Health Doctor Network, you can text doctor to 38470. We are collecting all of those names along the way, along the tour. We already have at least one doctor in every state for our telemedicine network, and it's going to grow even further. And I can see after tonight that we're going to have a group visit network too, where we're going to send people to, where we are going to drive cash-based demand for group visits in cities all across the country. Mark my words, that is definitely happening. All right. So the next phase in is coaching. So let's just say you're a person and you get involved in the culture and you're having a great time. You know, you're seeing healthy, being fun, now you're participating in these community events. You're going to these group visits, but it's just not happening. You just need a little bit more help. You need some one-on-one help. Do you go straight to the very high-priced functional medicine doctor at that stage? No, we're going to put you with a health coach, because ultimately, coaching is value-based care. This is a word that you're going to hear a lot, value-based care. And I'm just going to spit it into maths teacher mode just for a minute. Don't leave. It's going to be short, but it's not going to be boring. But essentially, value is essentially outcomes divided by cost. Right? That's what you're looking for. What kind of outcomes did I get at what kind of cost? And the reason why the health coach has to be at the front is because the health coach costs a lot less than the doctor. If the doctor's $500 an hour and the health coach is $50 an hour, the doctor has to be 10 times better at getting the same result to be the same value, right? Maths, did I lose you? It's too late for maths, isn't it? All right, so, but that's the fact. And so we started to look at it this year. So last year, we started to think about at New Health, our first thing was creating this virtual coaching service. And what we started to do was to think about how could we put people into three different categories and give them the appropriate care. Right, tier one is basically healthy, tier two is mildly chronic, and tier three is severely chronic. Right, ultimately what we thought is that tier three, severe chronic, multiple medications, multiple chronic diseases, they need the functional medicine doctor, right? You need a doctor to be able to work on the, you know, the polypharmacy situation. A health coach is not ready for that. But for the mildly chronically ill, where you're taking a few meds, you're not on any like hardcore meds, but you're taking meds here and there for symptoms, and you're not particularly healthy, we thought functional medicine trained health coaches could be a good fit there. And then healthy people, you know, they can just be involved in the education. They can have a health coach too. Now, I assumed that the world would kind of look like this. And this is before I met Pilar. I thought we've got a lot of healthy people, few that, and then, you know, down at the end. So we started working with our first employer client and found out that the world looks a bit more like this. And that's the healthy deviant, right? Out of the first employer that we worked with, 150 people, one person, not 1%, but one person was the healthy deviant, right? That's it. I didn't put two and two together until now, but like that's it. I'll tell you this right now. Three are expensive and going to be expensive in the future, no matter what care you give them. If we can reverse their chronic disease, then all the better, but they're going to be expensive. The game in the next 20 years to whether this country goes down like the Roman Empire or has a resurgence is based on whether we can get those number twos to be number ones or number threes. If they become threes, they are going to cost so much money that we're just going to run out of money, and 90% of GDP is going to be healthcare, and rather than 20% of what it is right now in healthcare, it'll be 90%. There'll be literally no other jobs apart from healthcare, right? You'll either have Alzheimer's or be caring with someone with Alzheimer's. That's literally how it's going to be. That is literally how it's going to be. I'm almost swearing, but that is the future if we go along the same way, right? So, two, getting the twos back into ones is possible. We did it last year with completely virtual only health coaches, physicians, supervised health coaches. We did it. We did it consistently. This is a green shoot in medicine, and it's about coaching. So my next guest is not a health coach. Well, maybe, I don't know, she'll tell you for herself, but was a registered dietitian in the state of Minneapolis, and is no longer. And as of tomorrow, is about to become a resident of California, but has a really powerful story to tell about deviance and about doing the right thing. So please welcome to the stage, Cassie Bjork.
I feel like I should dance. Are you guys awake? Does anybody else want to dance with me? There's something wrong with you. That's what I told myself over and over again. It had to be true. Because no matter what I did, no matter how many calories I counted, how low a fat I ate, how many marathons I ran, how many meals I skipped, I couldn't lose a pound. In fact, I was gaining weight, and not just like 1, 2, or 3 pounds, 5, 10, 15, 20 pounds. I was 20 pounds heavier than I am now. That's me, all three of me, and I was in school to become a registered licensed dietitian, the expert in all things food, metabolism, and weight related. And this was humiliating. I was following all of the dieting rules, eating low fat, low calorie, exercising twice a day, running marathons, and it wasn't working. Has this happened to anybody else? Good, it's not just me, okay. The only thing I was losing was my mind and my self-confidence and self-worth. It was my final year of dietitian school when I got the call. It was my mom, and it was about my dad. He was 47 years old at the time, and he was running a race in my hometown of White Bear Lake, Minnesota. And instead of sailing across the finish line like he always did, he walked across the finish line grabbing his chest, and he was rushed into immediate, major, unexpected heart surgery. And I was floored. My dad, to me, was the picture of health. He didn't drink. He didn't smoke. He ran 3 miles a day. He was so healthy. He was also following all of the same dietary approaches that I was, eating low fat, low calorie. He'd have oatmeal for breakfast every single morning with skim milk and sandwiches on whole grain bread with the little skinny slice of the fat-free cheese, a little bit of lean meat on there. He trimmed all the fat off of his meat when he ate it. The only difference between my dad and I was he never had a lick of dessert. And me, on the other hand, I ate these 100-calorie snack packs like they were going out of style. Anybody else? The snack wells, the 100-calorie snack packs? Yeah. Side note, on one of my exams to be a registered dietitian, one of the test questions was you had to choose between a 100-calorie snack pack or an avocado. Which would you recommend? I had to answer it wrong, or like against what I know is true, to get the question right. True story. Back to my dad. I'll never forget being in the hospital room after his surgery. And the doctor and the dietitian both came into the room. And I was so excited because I was in school to be a dietitian. And clearly, there was something I was missing. I was doing something wrong. Here, you know, my dad and I were both following the same approach. I was 20 pounds heavier. He's on the operating table, just got out of major surgery. So I was like really pumped up. Am I dancing up here? There we go. Okay. Oop. Okay. Well, we'll just leave it here for a second. I'll try not to dance too much anymore. So they told him, keep eating low fat. Eat low calorie. Don't ever look at a stick of butter again. Just use margarine. Don't eat egg yolks. Only eat the whites. Eat whole grains. Heart-healthy oatmeal for breakfast every day with a side of orange juice. And I was like, he's already doing all of those things. And they're like, great. Keep doing them. Gave him a handout with all the same information on there. And I was so frustrated and furious and confused. I was in school to teach people how to do all of these things that there's something wrong here, like something was missing, like what was happening. So a few years went by and I, you know, earned my RD, LD, those esteemed credentials. I was really proud. I worked really hard to get them. I landed an awesome job at a well-known hospital here in the Twin Cities, a clinical position. And I was teaching what I learned in dietitian school. And James mentioned earlier that moment, that intuition that you have, it just didn't feel right. It didn't make sense to me. I knew that something wasn't adding up. So in my free time, I was researching. I was looking at all the studies and all of the science, and what I found, I was dumbstruck by what I discovered. I learned that cholesterol might not be the villain that it was made out to be. In fact, it's an essential nutrient. I learned that high-fat diets might not be that bad after all. In fact, they might be better than low-fat diets because of how they regulate blood sugar and insulin. I learned that when it comes to weight loss, there's a lot more to it than just calories in and calories out. Nobody told me that. But there's a lot more that factors into it, things like hormones, thyroid, stress, sleep, supplements. This raised a lot of questions for me. Like, why was the foundation of our government's dietary recommendations, the food pyramid at the time, why was it carbs? Why did I have to answer that test question wrong? Why were they promoting packaged processed foods over a real food? Why was our country getting fatter and sicker and more disease-ridden if what I was learning in school to be a dietitian and what I was supposed to teach as a registered licensed dietitian was supposed to work? It really didn't make sense to me, and every new piece of information I learned bucked the very rules that I'd learned in dietitian school. So I became a rule breaker, and I quit. I quit the low-fat dieting. I quit the low-calorie nonsense. I ate more food, more fat, more calories, stopped exercising, started taking high-quality supplements, and to my pleasant surprise, everything changed for me. I didn't know what was happening at the time, but my inflammation levels were going down. My hormones were balancing out. I did realize my energy levels were soaring, my cravings were going down, and the weight just kind of like effortlessly came off. I didn't know that was possible. I was so excited. I was sharing this with everyone, and this message I started spreading, and it was catching on. People were loving the sounds of this, eating more, exercising less, getting back, you know, in the best shape of their life and gaining their health back. So I got contacted by all sorts of major media outlets and radio, and I got a regular television slot, and people loved hearing this, and it was working for people, not just me, but it was working for so many other people. And all of the research that I had come across became the foundation for our nationally recognized coaching program called Rule Breakers, Health and Weight Loss Coaching. And for the next 10 years, my team would grow into a bunch of dietitian coaches, and we'd lead our clients through this process where we help them lose weight and keep it off and heal chronic health ailments and tap into new levels mentally, physically, spiritually, emotionally, without counting calories, without skimping or starving, and taking a functional medicine-based approach to health and weight loss, and looking at all of the missing pieces of the puzzle that need to be addressed in order for our bodies to balance out. And the reason this approach works, the reason why we've been able to help hundreds of men and women over the past 10 years, is because our approach bucks the very rules that I learned in school to be a dietitian, and that I'm required to uphold in order to be a licensed dietitian. So, James mentioned that I gave up my dietitian license. So here's how this all went down. Just a few years into my career, the Minnesota Board of Nutrition and Dietetics came after me. They got word of what I was doing. They didn't agree with my principles, didn't agree with my approach, and they said I needed to stop. They sent me a cease and desist to stop my whole approach to health and weight loss. All they wanted me to talk about was food, not anything else, not supplements or sleep or stress or thyroid or hormones or any of the things that, well, I was attending talks and all of these things, getting continuing education credits from them, and I wasn't supposed to talk about any of it, just food. And the problem is, the reason why we were getting the results we were getting is because we were looking at the whole picture. Like, that's why it worked. So this wasn't an overnight decision, just to be clear. I really valued my credentials. I worked harder for them than anything I'd worked for my whole life. So for almost 6 years, I was in a battle with the board. And we're talking court dates and attorneys and attorney fees and mediations and interrogations and blood, sweat, tears, time, and energy. And I did this because I worked hard for them, and I valued them, and I respected them, and I really do respect credentials. But in the end, another moment of intuition, like, I was like, why am I working so hard to hang on to something that doesn't even align with anything that I know and believe to be true? So the decision actually became pretty easy. Did a lot of soul searching in the process, and in January of this year, I kissed my dietitian license goodbye. Thank you. Thank you. And it feels really, really good. And ever since hanging my shingle as a licensed dietitian, I still have my RD, by the way. They've been in contact with me a little bit as well, and I'm not too worried about keeping or losing it. It doesn't really matter at this point of the game, because we're going to keep doing what we're doing. We're going to keep helping people, and my mission is still the same, to help people break free of their chronic health conditions, their weight struggles, and really bust all of these myths that we have around dieting and what health really looks like. And the amazing thing is, it was so thrilling to see this firsthand and to see how this changed my whole life. And it was amazing to see my dad and how this changed his whole life. And today is actually, on this day, today is his 58th birthday, and he's healthier than ever, and it's just been so cool to see that change in him. And just as thrilling, it's amazing to work with people and see clients who have been, they feel like they've been given a death sentence. They've been told that something like their diabetes is irreversible, and it's only going to get worse from here, and then we help them reverse it. Or that their weight struggle it's because of your genetics or your age. It's not going to get better, especially when they're eating low fat, low calorie, right? And then they come to us and we help them lose the weight and they overcome these challenges that they've never thought were possible. And these people are literally in tears because they're able to step into the next phase of their life. They get to get themselves back. That's what happened to me. I got my life back. I loved life more than ever once I was able to step into these new levels. And we can do this together, and we need to be proactive, not reactive. We need to view the body as a whole, look at every system. We need to have our model based on truth, not lies, not BS. And if we can change the medical model, we can change anything. That's why I'm so grateful to be part of this, and I'm so honored to have James as a colleague, friend, and advocate for the future of health and for this new health tour, and just for all of you for being here. This is an incredible, important movement. I'm really grateful for each and every one of you here today. Thank you.
Thank you, Cassie. Look, it takes deviation from the norm to do it, and sometimes you have to do it with your credential. There's no way that, like, sleep and meditation and whatever has to be delivered by a doctor. Like, that's insane that that can only be delivered by a doctor. We have to let all health professionals have access to helping people with that kind of thing. So I just want to come up here for a second. Dr. Gehring, I want to say hi. So, you know, we've been in the business of taking doctors to functional medicine from conventional medicine. So Dr. Gehring, you know, we're about to go into the care section here, which is, we're going to talk about functional medicine for a moment. But do you want to just quickly tell us 2 minutes about your journey here?
Okay, hi. Well, I grew up in South Dakota, so I had to drive across that highway I-90 to get here. I actually went to residency in Eau Claire, Wisconsin, and learned family medicine. So I practiced in Chippewa Falls since 1999. And I always kind of thought of myself as more of a natural-minded doctor, and one of my pet peeves was giving a pill for a pill. So I thought I was kind of open-minded, but along the journey, I saw a lot of chronic illness that wasn't getting better, and it was just more and more frustrating. 2010, I started working with bioidentical hormones, and then in 2013, I had my I know I have to change moment. I went to the here in Minneapolis, the Applying Functional Medicine to Clinical Practice week-long course, and I came out of there truly blown away and thrilled with all the new tools that I had, and it was just, it took me back to the first year of med school, you know, how the body really works. But I also was really pissed, you know, really angry, and it took a bit for me to kind of get past that. I tried to start, you know, I kept learning more and more about functional medicine, took all the modules, tried to implement that in traditional medicine, and it was just hard. You're the weird doctor. You know, and it's a lot easier just giving lip service to, you need to change your diet and here's your Lipitor. It's so much easier to do that, but it just wasn't right. I started feeling like regular medicine was more and more malpractice. You know, just like you, it's just, you had to do something different. So
practice, right?
So in 2017, I opened my own little clinic. It's called Sparrow Wellness Clinic. Sparrow is Latin for hope. So that's what we hope to give our patients.
Amazing.
So,
all right, Dr. Gehring's just here. Wow, a lot of women deciding to use their intuition and not just being told what to do by a bunch of dudes living in the past. Sounds pretty cool to me. All right. We got one segment left and it's going to get a bit sciencey, but look, everyone here is passionate about functional medicine, but we can't give functional medicine to everyone in the way that it's being delivered now because it's too expensive and we're not going to save any money. We have to think about it. This, if you've gone through these journeys here and you still need help, you've gone through the coaching, the community, and the culture, and you're still chronically ill, that's where functional medicine comes in because the lifestyle is being delivered by either a much lower cost provider or by almost free stuff up here, right? Stuff that's almost free, the culture and the community. So this event tonight is called The Evolution of Endocrinology. We have in the house a very special guest who has actually created a test that is making this kind of root cause resolution available to way more people. Please welcome the founder of the Dutch test, Mark Newman.
Imagination. All right. Hey, I'm really glad to be here. Had some great chats with some of you before already. It's getting a little bit late, so I'll just jump right into it. You mentioned tools, and that's what we're going to talk about, which does not start with a C, so we're under the heading of care. But endocrinology tools, like how do we figure out what's wrong with people, right, from a laboratory standpoint? And for me, my journey sort of within functional medicine, it sort of parallels some of yours in that within functional medicine, I got sort of frustrated with the tools that were available to me because from a lab guy standpoint, I'm pretty greedy when it comes to data because I've seen so many cases where unless I have, you know, one particular piece of the puzzle, like I don't really know what's going on, right? And as you look at laboratory tests that have been available historically, you know, if I want the cortisol pattern, what do? I go get a saliva test and I do a saliva test. And then if I want to see the metabolites of hormones, then I'm going to go and do a urine test and I'm going to get those and maybe a few other tests and now I'm out $800, but I've got some really interesting information and if I can piece it together, you know, I've got some good tools to work with. So what my passion has been is trying to put all of this into one model of testing that's easy to do and affordable. So what we came up with was the Dutch test. So it's an acronym, dried urine test for comprehensive hormones. So from one test, we're able to do all of this. And so we got started with that about 6 years ago. And our approach was, you know, once we had this model built and it started to sort of seep into the functional medicine conversation, then we started to invest in the test itself by adding other things. So we added an oxidative stress marker, we added melatonin, we added a B6 deficiency marker and a B12 deficiency marker and a glutathione deficiency marker, all of which sort of fold into the same story. So we're going to talk about that a little bit tonight. And the reason is this, is because this is the kind of person that comes into your office, right? Maybe you're perimenopausal, fatigued, some depression, insomnia, losing your scalp hair, hot flashes, those types of problems that we're trying to find a solution for, right? And why do we want to do functional medicine? Because traditional approach to this is to say, okay, you know, which tool from which pill is going to eliminate these symptoms, right? And we can do better than that. But what we end up doing is saying, well, you know, maybe you're already self-medicating with caffeine for fatigue, and we can throw some Prozac at your depression, we can throw some sleep meds, and maybe some spironolactone, maybe some HRT, and we can sort of take care of some of these symptoms, right? And that's been, I think, traditionally the approach with allopathic medicine. And what functional medicine says, which has been said over and again, which is huge, is what are the root causes of these symptoms, right? Why are you not sleeping, right? Probably not a deficiency in a sleep med, but there's probably something going on there, right? So your options are to guess or test, which sounds a little bit cynical, but to be honest, I would put my health in the hands of a functional medicine provider that's intelligent, that doesn't happen to have a lab test in front of them, and they can do some really good things, right? Because you know a lot of information, a lot of these things make sense, and you can come up with some solutions that will get you somewhere. But the reality is with a lot of this stuff is there's a lot of overlap, right? You're tired. Okay, well, why? Maybe there's some lifestyle involved, but maybe your cortisol's low, but maybe it's not, maybe your testosterone's low, right? If you're losing your scalp hair, and the androgens, the testosterone picture, is the reason why, the solution's a whole lot different than if you're low thyroid, and that's what's driving your hair loss, right? So we need to figure out what's going on with this. So let me just go through a couple examples of kind of how we use this type of testing in functional medicine to find better solutions for the types of problems we've been talking about. So let's take estrogen as an example. So what's wrong with your estrogen? Well, maybe you're making too much, maybe you're not making enough, maybe you don't have enough progesterone to balance it, or maybe you have a metabolism problem, right? So let me show you a case where we start to see some things that make sense because we're looking so comprehensively at all of this. Do I have a laser pointer in here? Oh, in the middle. Got it. All right, so for those of you that are new to estrogens, these are your estrogen metabolites, right? This is your primary estrogen, estradiol. The way we plot our results is this little purple band here is the postmenopausal range, and the premenopausal range is up here. So it's sort of like a speedometer, right? So this person is what? High for estradiol, right? And they've got some symptoms of estrogen dominance. Okay, fine. So we can get that information from a blood test or a saliva test, and then we can start doing some things, right? We have this whole list in our toolbox that we can start addressing that with. But when we look more carefully, what we find with this patient is all of these estrogens are on the higher side of normal, or they're high, except this guy right here, right? The 2-hydroxyestrogens, which some of you are familiar with, which is a more friendly pathway as it relates to breast cancer risk. So we don't want to see that one lagging behind. The door's sort of closed. And for those of you that practice functional medicine, what's the key that opens that door or can open that door? Anybody? Right. So broccoli, cruciferous vegetables have indole-3 carbonyl in them, right? And if you give someone indole-3 carbonyl or the metabolite of, which is DIM, diindolemethane, look what happens. So here's a patient before and after. So all of these are much better balanced, and this one's higher, right? Now, this guy over here, the 4-hydroxyestrogen, causes breast cancer, so we don't like to see that one, so it's nice to see that it's lower. But what we've done is taken a more intelligent approach to this person's estrogen dominance, right? They're not making too much estrogen. They just have this drain plugged, right? And we've taken a really specific tool that's in our little toolbox as functional medicine providers and implemented it, right? And so this kind of testing can be really helpful to find out why, right? What's the root cause of what's going on, okay? So we're opening up that door, and we like the way that looks. So that can get a little bit complex. Not quite as complex as cortisol can get, right? Those of you that work with patients that are struggling with depression or fatigue or things related to cortisol know it can be really complex. And this is the main variable of why I developed the testing that we have. Because you get some information out of saliva, you get some information out of urine, and we want to put all of this together in one test. Because what do I want to know? Are you making too much? Are you not making enough? Maybe you have a dysfunctional up and down pattern, right? My mom has low cortisol in the morning and high at night, right? She makes about the right amount, but that is a recipe for trouble, right? She's not sleeping well and, you know, all sorts of things, right? So, or maybe there's a problem with the metabolism of cortisol. So we can see all of these things with the Dutch test, which is helpful in cases like this. Now, how many of you are healthcare providers? So that's probably you. So when we test doctors, they tend to look like this, which is, you know, your cortisol in the morning is supposed to hop up and then come back down. And if it overdoes it, what does that mean? It means you probably have a pretty stressful life, or you've had stress for so long that this whole system is just overactive, right? And that's gonna be a problem, right? So first off, take care of yourself, then take care of your patients, right? But we see this pattern a lot with people who have like high stress jobs, and we can see they're making a lot of cortisol, right? So we can see that with saliva, we can see it with our urine Dutch test. Here's what we're adding into the picture, and this gets a little bit more complex, but some profound things start to come out of the picture when we look at this. We see, okay, free cortisol is only 1% of the total. What happens if we look at the metabolites of cortisol, which represent more like 70 or 80% of all the stuff that you're making, right? If this is also elevated, it just confirms this story, right? Hey, you make a lot of cortisol, right? But what if the metabolites, what if the metabolites are actually low? Now it's a completely different picture of someone who's making a little bit of this cortisol, but they can't get rid of it, right? They make the cortisol, but their metabolites are low because they're not excreting it right. Why? A lot of times what we see is that's a thyroid issue. The thyroid is directly related to how your body processes cortisol, right? So this is what functional medicine is all about, is trying to piece all of this together to ask the question of why. Why are you depressed? Well, maybe it's because you have too much cortisol. Why? Maybe there's a thyroid issue that's also concurrent that we need to get to the bottom of if we're going to find health for you. And cortisol, as we know, is an issue for both depression and diabetes. So let's do a little bit of biochemistry, and I'll show you. This is interesting to a chemist. We'll see how interesting it is to you. So how does it actually cause it, though, right? So tryptophan, amino acid, goes to NAD, right? You need B6 in order to do this. And guess what upregulates this pathway? Cortisol. So if you're stressed and you have a lot of cortisol, it's going to push it this way. And you need a lot of B6 in order to do that. And so if you run out of B6 because you're doing too much of that, there it goes, right? You're going to take a right-hand turn and you're going to make this guy right here. So this is part of the Dutch test. Why? because it's a B6 deficiency marker. But it goes further than that. It also complexes to insulin. So if you feed this stuff, this little B6 marker, if you feed it to rats, they get diabetes. Like this is part of the causal way that stress leads to lots of cortisol, leads to this stuff, and increases your risk of getting diabetes. So if this is the reason why, do we want to give you metformin? Maybe, but maybe there's a better solution if we can do what functional medicine doctors do so well, which is get to the root cause, right? Then it goes further, and it steals your tryptophan that's supposed to make serotonin, right? So now you have a deficiency of serotonin, and we've also got a little serotonin metabolite marker on the Dutch test, and this is what leads to what? Depression, right? So you can see the root cause of this might be lifestyle, might be something that you can intervene with as a functional medicine provider, but being able to piece all these pieces together gives you a better chance to find the right solution for your patients. So this is what we built, is this test that has all this information on it, which for me, it's a really great test. You're never gonna get rid of blood testing, right? You need your thyroid panel, you need your CBCs and your blood chems and all these things that go along with lab testing. But when it comes to the endocrine system and these hormones, you just get a lot more information. So what I've seen historically is that functional medicine providers have said, okay, I can get this stuff out of blood. Testosterone metabolism and these vitamin deficiency markers are too expensive, so I'm gonna stick with this. So what's your big missing piece there? Which blood testing really struggles with is cortisol, right? You don't get a lot of good answers for cortisol from blood testing. So then what do? You go grab a salivary test. Now we're getting a little bit expensive and we still don't have estrogen metabolism or any of these vitamin deficiency markers that really help round out the picture. So when you're starting to get up in this $600, $800 world, right, you gotta start picking and choosing what you want in order to get the answers you want. And so that's why we're developing testing products that you can use that are easy for your patient, that can just give you a lot of information so you can go sleuthing in on that patient case and see what's going on. So that's the world that we've built in urine hormones. I love listening to what you're doing with people in your group sessions. For us, I'm an analytical chemist, so all I get is a piece of paper and some urine, which is great for me because we're antisocial types, us chemist people. But this is the side where we come in with trying to find solutions to figure out really what's at the heart of whatever it is, whether it's depression or sleep issues or what have you, and to do it in a way that's cost-effective. You know, when we're doing this test, what we've just kept it simple. We said we're going to keep our price low. We'll arm your patient with an insurance receipt, and usually they get around 65, 70% reimbursement, and now they're out $100, right? So this is what we're passionate about, and we are passionate about giving you guys tools to use in your practice as you try to keep this mission moving forward, and we're really grateful to be here. Thanks, James.
Guys, I just have to say, this is the evolution of endocrinology here. Can you see why doctors should be doing this and not telling people how to like meditate? Doctors, the few functional medicine doctors that we have need to be doing this because this is out of the scope of the health coach, right? So we need to get the right people on the right seats on the bus if we're going to create health and do it at a reasonable cost. And the reason why when we did this tour, we got to choose who we wanted to work with, and we worked with Dutch Test, is because they've created a reasonably priced test. So on the September 24th at 8 p.m., if you go to goevomed.com/hormones, we've had so much interest from practitioners about the Dutch Test. We're going to do a special webinar that Mark and I are going to do. We're going to go deeper into a lot more cases so that the doctors and other clinicians can be part of it. Really, really excited to be partnering with Dutch Test because they get it. It's about the cash economy. Now I'm going to start swearing, if you guys are ready. So, not quite yet. So, as you see this, we thought it's, you know, people would always say to us, this sounds like a new standard of care. We need a new standard of care. And I say, yeah. And luckily, our company's called New, so we're going to make the new standard of care. And it says, it's patient-centered. do no harm. We'll go through it piece by piece. But patient centers, our members take ownership of their health data, and their wellness goals, and their deviance. We'll add that in for sure. Second, do no harm. There's a principle in naturopathic medicine called the therapeutic order, where you start with the least costly, least invasive things first, and then work your way up. You can see that's happening in the five circles, right? You can see that that's happening there. Third, lifestyle foundation, right? It's all in this book. It's been taught in clinics around the country. It's been taught by dietitians and help there and support. We need to find ways to sleep, eat, move, cleanse, connect. The lifestyle foundation has to be there. Then we have the sort of functional medicine operating system part of it. So system thinking. We have to identify the cause, and we have to integrate modalities, right? We have to have practitioners working together, integrating those modalities. This is the functional medicine piece. Interactive ecosystem. We have to get the data part right. And then last, a community leadership. Our veteran community members mentor and inspire new members. I can't tell you how many we've already had, even in New Health so far, with people who came through our coaching program. As soon as they get better, they're like, I want to be a health coach. That was amazing. Like, I've never had a medical interaction like that. I want to do it. This is how you make exponential change, is by having people who get help, help 100 other people. All right, so what do you guys think about the new standard of care? This is the standard of care that will be just the way that it's done. Because, you know, when you start your own health cost sharing community, you can do whatever you want. You can operate your own health cost, you can open your own thing. And so now we're going to talk about this, this middle part, health cost sharing. Health cost sharing is built on the community, or new is built on the cross-section of community, the cash economy, and reversing chronic disease. Now, I'm going to tell you something. The cash economy works better for patients and providers, right? For providers, if you get paid cash now rather than paid maybe by insurance at a minimal fraction of the cost in 3 months, it's clearly better. You don't need any convincing. But is the cash economy better for patients? Because most of your experience with integrating with functional medicine at this point is probably that when you're paying cash, you're paying over and above what you already pay for health insurance. So you're like, oh, the cash economy sucks for me. Does it? Let me look at this, and this goes back to what you were speaking to earlier, Cara. This is a lab chart cost comparison, right? And your lab. So let's just say you're just a regular person. You go in with, you have regular insurance. You show up at your doctor's office, and you have a high deductible. And they say, oh, you need a homocysteine test. They charge your insurance $737.18. Right? That goes up to your insurance because you haven't met your deductible, that comes straight back down to you. If you had gone directly to the lab, that would have cost you $17.50. Now, I don't know if you guys have a word for this in Minneapolis, but in the UK, we call this a fucking scam, right? This is a scam, my friends, and we will not stand for this scam anymore. And ultimately, in our system, everyone will pay this price because we've negotiated. It's the same thing. It's Quest or it's LabCorp, right? The same people are doing the work at the other end. It's who paying the bill. You cannot control costs if you pay these prices. You cannot. You can easily control costs if you pay these prices. We have to create an ecosystem where we rid ourselves of the scam. Clearly, LabCorp and Quest are happy to do it for this, because that's our pricing. So if patients and providers both work better on a cash economy and these people get paid, who else is left, right? Who else, who's this money going? It's going to the middlemen. It's going to insurance, right? It's going all of that. You know, the world is moving towards transparency. Middlemen are getting taken out left, right, and center. It's happening through the blockchain. It's happening in all different ways, and it's going to happen through medicine because we're going to do it at New Health. We're going to put the patient first. We're going to take care of the providers, and we're going to make sure that we save costs. A million Americans today, the reason why I know this is going to work is because a million Americans today use health cost sharing. They just all happen to be Christian, or people who pretend to be Christian, to be part of a health cost sharing, right? And that's that. So, you know, I'm not going to tell you which of those categories that I fall into, but I will tell you that I'm a member of one of these, because for a man of 37 years old with a wife of childbearing age and a five-year-old daughter, the cheapest insurance that I could get at my income level was $1,600 a month through the ACA, and I pay $449 a month through this. So I have $1,100 a month, $14,000 a year to spend on any of the weird medicine that I want in my community. And who am I, the person to tell you whether you should have chiropractic or acupuncture? No, you know, right? You know what works for you, and you choose because it's your money, because you've kept it, because you're not giving it to Aetna, right? We are starting the new health community. Today is the first day that you can sign up as a founding member. Later next month, you'll get all the pricing of how much it costs, and there's going to be different pricing depending on how old you are, right? It's cheaper for younger people. It's based on historical claims. Two, if you're a single, or if you're a family, or if you're just a couple without a child, or if you're a single parent, different pricing. And also, you're going to get to choose your deductible level. It's actually called an unshared amount. We're going to have to learn to use a different language in our new community. But all of those things will come out in October. And then November 1st is open enrollment. So that's where we're going to have the kickoff. That's when Deepak and all these other big health celebrities are going to mail to their communities on our behalf to kickstart this revolution. But if you want to be a founding member, you can sign up today. You can go to newhealth.com. You can pay $100 to become a founding member, and you're going to answer some questions about how much it costs right now, about how much, you know, how much it'll cost later. You're going to tell us in your exact words what your frustrations are with medicine, and you're going to tell us why, what you'd like to see in a plan, and we're going to use those words in our marketing copy, and we're working on that right now. So if you want to be a founding member of New Health, you can do it right now. You can go to newhealth.com. This is what you're going to get. The first thing is you're going to get a supportive community of healthy deviants, right? We are going to be a supportive community. We're going to do community batch cooking. We're going to put people in groups together, and we're going to facilitate community as the transformational health force that it is. If you can reduce healthcare costs by 40% in Albert Lea, Minnesota, I think we can do 50%. Anyone else think that we can do that? You're going to have 24/7 access to a doctor. If you need, sometimes you need a prescription at 3 a.m, right? Not as many times as you probably think, but sometimes you do. We have contracted with a company that will get you in front of a doctor at 3 a.m. It's called Teladoc. You'll never see that doctor again, but you do know that he is licensed in the state. But who cares? At that point, you just need what you need, and that's what you're going to get. Next, you're going to get your functional medicine trained health coach who's going to help you stay well, who's going to help you empower you through your own health data, who's going to help you implement the healthy behaviors that you know that you should be doing that you may or may not be doing, depending on how deviant you are. And then the last part is a billing concierge, and this is the most important part. Never again will you be on the phone with Aetna trying to see if your thing's covered, right? Does anyone else love a future where that never happens again? What about a person who you call up when you need anything more than a single visit and say, hey, I've got to have an MRI, and they can tell you the five places closest to you where it costs? Because guess what? An MRI just down the road is $2,500 for cash, and just a mile further down the road is $500. And it's the same machine, right? It's the same machine that's happening. You know, when we spoke to the partners that we're working with who facilitate the Christian ministries, they said, everyone is a cash-paying patient, but everyone is not alone. You are part of a cost-sharing community. It is our right and it is our role as each members of this cost-sharing community to make sure that we reduce our costs as much as possible, because we're responsible for 1/10,000th of the cost. And if we reduce our healthcare costs significantly, we as a community will benefit from that. So who feels like this is a much better way of organizing our healthcare, and who thinks that this is a better version of insurance? So this is it, the New Health Community. Founding membership opens today. You can go to newhealth.com. The opportunity for us to take functional medicine to the masses The opportunity for us to take functional medicine to the masses is not to make it cheaper or to like do it slightly differently and all these kind of things. It is to go where the pain point is. For most American humans, the pain point is that 7% of people trust their insurance company. There is a complete lack of trust. You know why? Look at these numbers. Humana, United, Cigna, Aetna, Anthem. Look at those share prices in 9 years, right? You think the ACA was created to help poor people? Think again. It's bullshit. It was the biggest gift to the health insurance industry that's ever been created. The numbers are right there in front of you. And if you keep paying them, it's like paying the fossil fuels. It's like continuing to invest in fossil fuels. I'm sorry, but that is a fact. We have an opportunity as a community to not ask for anyone's permission to change the system, but to actually just do it. And all you have to do is to divest. So in November, when everyone's worrying, healthcare is the biggest issue in this year's election, and when everyone is wondering, should it be blue or should it be red, we can vote with our dollars and go green. And that is what I'm asking for all of you. It's not a fit for everyone. It's not a fit for people on Medicare. It's not a fit for people under 26 because they could be on their parents' insurance. It's not really a fit if you have a full-time job and your insurance is paying for it. But that still leaves 40 million people and a hell of a lot of independently employed health professionals who can start this revolution. And if we do this, we get to decide what the future of healthcare looks like and not anyone else. So I really appreciate all of you being here today. And when it comes to November, vote new. Thank you. The merch table is just out to the left. At the merch table, you can sign up to be a founding member. Go see my wife, Rachel. Tell her.